I'm going to close with this one last verse, Jonah 3:10. Go ahead and turn to Jonah 3:10. You say, why is this so important? You know, Jonah 3:10 pretty much sums it up here. So I'll close on this. It says in Jonah 3:10, and God saw their works. What did God see?
Works.
God saw their works, comma. And now he's going to tell us what those works were. That they turned from their evil way, and God repented of the evil that he had said that he would do unto them, and he did it not. That right there says that when you turn from your evil way, that's your works. So if you believe that a person has to turn from their evil way and believe on Christ, here's what you're saying. They have to believe on Christ and have works. And you know what? The Bible says salvation is without works. And Jonah 3:10 says turning from your sins or turning from your evil way is works. So that's why this is such an important doctrine. You see, the devil wants to get you to trust your works to save you. All the way back to Cain and Abel, he's trusting his works instead of the blood of the Lamb. All the way back to the Tower of Babel, they're trying to do their works to get them to heaven. All throughout Galatians, he warns us, it's a false gospel when you think that you're justified by works. All throughout Romans, he tells us we're not justified by works. I mean, he warns us, look, trust Christ for salvation. Don't trust works. So basically, the devil wants to get in the back door. He doesn't just want to come right out and say, trust works, okay? You're like, well, no, the Bible says not to trust works. So he's like, well, it's not works, but you do have to repent of your sins. Well, I'm not saying it's works, but you just can't live however you want. I mean, you gotta do something, right? You gotta at least go to church 3 times a month or something. I mean, you gotta do something, right? No, you have to do nothing. Because Jesus did everything. You believe on Christ, his works are sufficient. We don't have to add to his works. He paid it all. Now let me ask you something. Is God trying to hide salvation from us? No, he wrote the book of John that we might believe on Christ and that believing we might have life through his name. Look, if repenting of your sins was something that we had to do to be saved, wouldn't God tell us that? So why do all these preachers say you have to repent of your sins to be saved when the term repent of your sins is never found in the Bible once? I mean, isn't that a fair question? If the Bible never one time says repent of sin, and that's something that we have to do to be saved, good night! Why didn't he warn us? Why didn't he tell us? But look, I have hundreds of verses that say believe. Why? Because believing is what you have to do to be saved. See, the book of John is the only book in the Bible that claims to be a book written to get somebody saved. See, most of the Bible is written to people that are already saved. You know, you look at a book like Ephesians, Galatians, Philippians, those are written to the saints. It says it right at the beginning of the book. Written to the churches of Galatia. The book of Romans is written to the saved. It says it's to the saints which are in Christ Jesus. Is Romans written to the unsaved? No. It says it's written to the saints which are in Christ Jesus. But you know what? The only book in the Bible that claims to be written unto the unsaved to get them saved is the book of John. And at the end of the book of John, he says, these things are written that you might believe on the Son of God, and I'm paraphrasing, but he said, and that believing you might have life through his name. He claims that that's why the book is written. Okay, that's why the Bible in the book of John says believe in almost every chapter. Because if it's a book about getting somebody saved, it's going to talk a lot about believing. That's why in John, right away in John 1:12, he says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. That sounds like a great book for getting somebody saved. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. John 3:15 says the same thing. John 3:36 says, he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. You know, right away, John 5:24, verily, verily, I say to thee, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death to life. John 6 repeatedly says that you have to believe to have eternal life. Several times in that verse 40, I think, verse 41, I know for sure, verse 47. You get into chapter 7, he says, whosoever believeth. You get into chapter 9, dost thou believe on the Son of God? You get into chapter 10, it's believe. You get into chapter 11, it's I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? And the book of John says, believe, 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 believe. And it says this book is written that you might believe and be saved and have eternal life. It's written to the unsaved to get them saved. How many times is the word repent found in the book of John? Zero. Not even once. So if that's the big important thing, why is it never even mentioned one time? Say, well, that's dumb because it's mentioned in these other books. Look, if it's not written in the book of John, then John is not an adequate book to save you if you have to do that to be saved. Right? I mean, if all I have the book of John, it says, well, this book says it's written so that people will get saved. I can't even show the whole gospel from John as far as what you have to do to be saved. That doesn't make any sense. False doctrine never makes sense. You know what makes sense to me? It makes sense to me that I'm a sinner, that I deserve hell, and that I'm unworthy of being saved no matter how much I clean up my life. Because all my righteousnesses to God are as filthy rags. That makes sense. And it makes sense that Jesus died for all my sins and paid my punishment for me, and all I have to do is just turn to him and just believe on him and be saved. That makes sense. But you know what doesn't make sense? Telling me that I have to turn from all my sins to be saved and then turning around and telling me, oh, by the way, it's a free gift that Jesus did everything. It's like, what, did Jesus do everything? Jesus did everything, but you got to make some serious change in your life. Well, did Jesus do everything or not? Is it free or not? Is it a gift or not? Is it faith alone or not? It's funny, we were out soul winning the other day, and we asked somebody what they have to do to be saved. They said, believe on Christ. And they said, yeah, I don't know why people make the gospel so complicated. It's just so simple. It's just so, Jesus did everything. We just believe on Jesus. It's so simple. And I'm thinking like, yeah, it is simple. And then that same person, I asked that person if you could lose your salvation. Oh yeah, you can lose your salvation. I mean, you can't just live however you want, and you know, you do have to repent of all your sins, and you know, if you don't live right, if you don't go to church, you're like, what? I said, now you're making it complicated. Don't be turned from the simplicity in Christ, that's in Christ, to another gospel, another Jesus, another salvation. Here in Hebrews 6:1, the Bible talks about us repenting from dead works. You say, well, what does that mean, dead works? Well, think about this. Faith without works is dead, right? So if you have faith without works, that's dead faith, right? So what if you have works without faith? That's dead works. See what I mean? So faith without works is dead faith, and works without faith is dead works. Look, works that you're doing, where you think you're serving God, but you have not believed on Jesus Christ, are dead works. Like, for example, there are people out there like the Apostle Paul who are very zealous of religion. And if you remember, the Apostle Paul, before he got saved, his name was Saul, he was very zealous of religion, okay? He was very serious about the Jews' religion, and he was a Pharisee, and he kept the Old Testament law to the best of his ability, and he was trusting in those works that he was doing to get him to heaven, right? But in order to be saved, he had to turn from that and put his faith in Jesus Christ. And you say, well, did he really turn from all that? He said, you know what? Those things, I counted them as dung. He said, I profited above many mine own equals in my own religion. I excelled in the Jews' religion. I was zealous of the Jews' religion. But he says, but what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Let me tell you something. There are people today that are serving the Lord, they think, with dead works. They have not believed on the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. They do not have salvation. They do not have the Holy Spirit inside of them. They are working their way to heaven in their mind. They think that they're going to earn their way to heaven. And there are people that are serving food to the homeless today. There are people who are ushering in their church today. There are people who are getting up and teaching a Sunday school class today and teaching the Bible today. Look, I've talked to people who teach Sunday school that will tell you they don't even believe the Bible, but they teach Sunday school just because they think it's just a good work to do. It's just a good community service or something, you know, because the Bible has good morals in it. Look, there are people today who do not believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, their Savior. Maybe they believe in a false religion like Mormonism, like Catholicism, like Islam today, or Judaism today. And they're doing a lot of works, right? And they're doing works, and they think that those good deeds and good works that they're doing are going to get them to heaven. Those are dead works. Because without faith, it is impossible to please Him. Nothing that we do. The Bible says they that are in the flesh cannot please God. Did you hear that? If you're in the flesh, you cannot please God. Without faith, it's impossible to please Him. So all the works that people are doing when their faith's not in Jesus Christ, those are dead works. Now look, if you talk to people out on soul winning, you go out and knock doors and talk to people, you run into people that are saved, don't you? That'll tell you that they're trusting Jesus to save them. And they're trusting in Christ alone, right? When you run into people that are not saved, what are they usually trusting? 9 times out of 10? Their works. You ask them, oh, you're going to heaven? How do you know you're on your way to heaven? Oh, because I go to church, I live a good life, I read the Bible, and they say, they give off their works. So doesn't it make sense that in order to have faith in Christ, you have to turn from trusting in good works to trusting in Christ, right? I mean, if you're trusting your works, you can't say, well, I believe in Jesus, but I also believe I'm going to heaven because I'm such a good person. Well, see, now you're trusting two different things. You're trusting your works and Jesus. That's like trying to trust Buddha and Jesus, Muhammad and Jesus, Mary and the saints and Jesus. No, it ought to be all Jesus. And you can't believe in all your Greek false gods and paganism and say, I believe in pagan Greek false gods, but I also believe in Jesus. No, well, you can't trust your works and Jesus. You must turn from idols to Jesus. You must turn from your works to Jesus. And you know what your works are? They're dead works because they're not accompanied by faith in Christ. Now, once you have faith in Christ, hopefully you should go out and do some good works, right? Then you'll have faith and works. Then neither your faith nor your works are dead, right? And you're going to receive a reward for the works that you do.